Obviously, the developments of these past few weeks have been what they are. The anniversary of 9/11, 20th anniversary is at hand. So, first question I would have is, in your view, is the U.S. safer now than it was 20 years ago at this time? And how do we now deal, given the withdrawal, with terrorist threats from within Afghanistan, such as the ones that resulted in the 9/11 attacks?
So the cumulative impact of the amazing work our young soldiers and sailors and airmen and Marines have done these last 20 years has absolutely made us safer. I saw it firsthand when I was a CIA director and then as Secretary of State. I watched the good counterterrorism work that the United States was doing with its friends and partners around the world. We disrupted lots of things that could have really hurt Americans. And so all fantastic, important work to disrupt terrorism around the world. A huge improvement from where we were 20 years ago. Unfortunately, the events of these last months, not just weeks, but the initial decision by President Biden to put a date certain on withdrawal before we got Americans out, before we got our equipment out, before the conditions were right, increases risk from where we were just 7 or 8 months ago. So over some period of time, the disruption, the chaos, the debacle that we've seen over these last 3 weeks unfold, not only tragically killed 13 Americans, but increases the longer-term risk of terrorism coming from Afghanistan.
Right. Mr. Secretary, you've said during your tenure the conditions were not right to conduct evacuations. What could have made them right at that time, and how would this have been handled differently if President Trump and you were still in office?
Well, we were very clear about what those conditions were for our entire time, and your point's well taken. We went from 15,000 uniformed military personnel to about 8,600. We stopped and paused to see what the conditions were right. Could we keep stability? Could we keep order? Could we continue to secure American interests there? When we saw that we could, we went down to roughly 4,800. Again, thoughtful, orderly, stable, or Afghanistan, stable set of conditions. Ultimately, the president made a decision we could get down to about 2,500. We did that. And at that level, at 2,500, for all that time, not a single American was attacked by the Taliban, not one. This is unheard of in Afghanistan. We had delivered a deterrence model. We knew, and the Taliban knew, that if they attacked an American or threatened an American interest, that we'd come make them pay a real price. We did that multiple times, and we had the deterrence that one needed for that stability. The question you got to was, well, what would have been the right conditions? It was an actual delivery of a break with Afghanistan, a serious effort for peace and reconciliation with the rest of the Afghans. Remember, we weren't just talking to the Taliban. That's what everybody's focused on. I was talking to the people in the north. I was talking to the Afghan government. I was talking to folks in the western part, in Herat and west, women's groups, NGOs. We were working alongside of our plan to protect America's interests. We were working to try and create better conditions for the people of Afghanistan as well. All of that would have needed to come together for us to get ultimately to what President Biden decided to do over a matter of weeks.
Mr. Secretary, why were the release of 5,000 prisoners? Why did that have to be part of the deal?
Well, these were Afghan prisoners held by the Afghans, imprisoned by the Afghans. They came to us as part of the conversation around how we were going to deliver this set of outcomes, these conditions that I just spoke about. We identified a bunch of folks who said, nope, we don't want you to release those. They didn't release any of those. And then they ultimately made the decision that they were going to release these others. There were lots of constraints on the Afghan government and their ability. In the end, it was part of the deliberations and conversations that we were hopeful going to lead to the right conditions.
Given what has occurred under the Biden administration and him pointing back at the deal that you and President Trump made, mm-hmm. You couldn't anticipate that you were going to win the election or lose the election.
Right.
In retrospect,
right.
Do you feel that, are there any regrets? Obviously, I'm sure you regret losing the election, but in terms of the deal itself, in retrospect, should there have been something done differently to protect against conditions that we've now seen in the past month?
The people of the United States didn't permit us to continue the very mission that we were on. I got a pink slip on January 20th. I am convinced that this would be in a very different place today. And while one can't prove that, I can only tell you what we did and how we maintained for 4 years. Right? President Trump wanted out. I supported that. That was the right thing, was to get our boys and girls home was the right answer. He also wanted to make sure that we did so in an orderly way and that we had the capacity to know what was going on in Afghanistan to protect from a future attack from that place. We were well on the path towards achieving that. I think we got it largely right. We were working to reduce the risk that we'd have some of our young kids killed, but we had also maintained America's capacity to protect and secure its interests. This administration chose a different path. You know, they talk about the deal we struck. We struck a deal that was conditions-based and said, if you do all these things you've committed to, we'll ultimately withdraw all of our forces. They never did. And unfortunately, President Biden chose to ignore the deal that we struck, to walk away from it, and instead make the unilateral decision to pick an arbitrary deadline to depart Afghanistan.
And given the deaths of the 13 service members, and given the fact that there are, I guess the Biden administration says, 200 to 250 American citizens left behind, and obviously thousands of Afghan allies, what repercussions, short of the ballot box, do you see on the horizon, perhaps politically, for the president, the current president of the United States?
Yeah, step one is always to get answers to really important questions. There are things that I can't answer for you here today. I can't tell you why they chose to close down Bagram Air Base while you still had a massive amount of equipment. The place you could actually move and flow product and material was through Bagram. I can't tell you why he picked a date certain. I can't tell you why he acted surprised when Kabul fell in the sequence that it did. Those are all important questions. I hope Congress will conduct good oversight to get answers to those so the American people can see this. Those have ramifications, not just political ramifications, but ramifications for how we think about providing the security we need for our men and women who choose. Right? I had American diplomats in the embassy in Kabul. I reduced the scope of the number of diplomats who were there. I wanted to take down risk for the people that I was responsible for. This administration will have to explain and account for what they did, why they chose to do what they did, and I hope we will learn lessons. This isn't punitive. I hope we will learn lessons from this about how you maintain a deterrence model. I hope this administration will figure out how to get that right. And then, in the end, the American people will get a chance to vote and elect the leaders they want, protecting their interests around the world. A
couple quick ones. I know we're running short. While they are proclaiming victory, do you see this? Do you see any measure of victory in this, in where we are today?
No, the sequence, the withdrawal, the nature of this exit is not a victory for America. Leaders around the world are questioning whether America will be a good friend, a good partner, a good ally. Our adversaries are seeing weakness from this administration. This has second-order impacts that are real. And America's credibility is at stake. I hope this administration will take some set of actions which will begin to restore that trust and credibility with our partners, our friends, our allies, and with the American people.
Hearing the, I guess, if you don't mind, a little bit of frustration in your voice about the way things have turned out, does this situation, how does it influence your thinking about 2024? I mean, it's got to have some influence.
It's not frustration, it's sadness and some anger. Sadness that we had 13 Americans killed, anger that we didn't continue to deliver on those two important objectives that the president had set out for our administration, and that we just didn't get the chance to protect those really important American interests makes me angry. We're now just like less than 2 weeks out from the anniversary of 9/11. We had all of those people killed here in New York and in Washington and in Pennsylvania. We need to be mindful that the world is a difficult, dangerous, dark place, and America has a responsibility to keep its own people safe. In this case, our leadership wasn't able to execute that.
And I know you're looking, you know, politically to 2022 to help as many Republicans as possible. Do you see, I know we shouldn't be politicizing this, but let's face it, it is, you know, politics is what makes sense. Politics means policy. So when you look to 2022 in the midterms, do you see this as more, I don't know, ammunition or more impetus for a turnover of the Congress? And again, for yourself, I know it's a long way off, but does this influence you in any way in terms of your own political plans for possibly running?
It certainly reminds me how important it is that good people step forward and put themselves forward and make the case to the American people about how they'll behave. So this certainly is a reminder of how serious our elections really are and how much they matter. That won't be lost on me as Susan and I think and pray about what we're going to do with the rest of our time here. As for 2022, I hope people will take this into account when they think about who they're going to vote for, whether they're city council or school board or for Senate or for Congress or for governors. I hope people will take this account. People need to evaluate. Those persons who put themselves forward should be scrutinized and evaluated, and we should determine, do they have the mettle, the spine, the intellect to build out a team that can deliver things that matter for the American people. This administration clearly failed in that. Not only these last few weeks, but the entire 7 months, this policy process. They're continuing to negotiate with the Iranians who are holding Al-Qaeda's senior leadership in their capital. But I hope the American people will consider these things. They seem far away, but I'll tell you what, when terror gets brought home, people will be reminded all too quickly. And I pray that Americans, when they go vote in elections, there's some elections in the fall of this year, and elections, big elections again in November of 2022, I hope and pray that people will consider who they're leading and make sure they get people of character who have the resolve and determination to be fearless in protecting America.
One quick local question about 2022. We have a, you know, in New Hampshire, we only have two congressional House seats, so it becomes a pretty big deal, half the state, right? So we have a pretty crowded field on the Republican side already for next year, including someone you may know, Matt Maurer, who worked for the State Department under yourself and your predecessor. He's one of five candidates. There might be a sixth. We're reported that the wife of former Ambassador Brown is thinking about it. Will you get involved in primary endorsements? What do you think of Matt? Will we see Secretary Pompeo at some point weighing in on a primary here?
John, I've gotten involved in a lot of primaries already. I'm not averse to doing that. If I think I know the character and nature of a particular Republican, I think they'd be best suited for it, I'm happy to weigh in. I'm not ready to do that here just yet, but I will certainly. I do know Matt. Matt did great work for the United States of America when he was working as part of the institution I was tasked to lead. All in good time with the right sequence. I love crowded primaries. That's how I got elected the first time. There were 7 or 8 or 9 of us, I think, at one point. I want people to put themselves forward to make the case for why it ought to be them, and then let voters sort of evaluate them and figure out how to sift and sort. I think that's an important part of what our party has historically done. It sounds like New Hampshire is going to do that in the robust tradition that New Hampshire has. Bless you all for that.
And finally, what's your message this afternoon, this evening, on the education choice event that's going on with Secretary DeVos?
So I spent these last 4 years working on problem sets abroad, and it reminded me of the work that I had done before that. I'd worked in Kansas on educational issues an awful lot of time, not only in Congress, but even when I was a private citizen. The work abroad reminded me that the greatest risk to our republic is our failing educational systems. If we don't get it right here, if we don't teach our kids real American history, if we don't educate our kids in the capacity to read and write and do the basic skill sets, if we don't build children of character, our republic can be lost. And so I'm here today talking about how we can make sure and give parents and families the capacity to give their kids the opportunity to go have every bit of that. Kids in disadvantaged environments, kids that come from different backgrounds and places, I want them all to have the choices and the opportunities to go get what those parents want for their children from an educational perspective. I'm convinced if we do that, then we'll reclaim our schools, we'll reclaim our educational system, and our republic will still be the most exceptional nation 240 or 250 years on.